There may be a reason you have heard of Thelma Todd. She had played in 59 films before her untimely and mysterious death in 1935. Chances are, if you've heard of her, it wasn't for her movies. The sad truth is that a majority of those who have heard of Thelma Todd only know her for one reason. Many conspiracies surrounded her unfortunate passing, and it seemed as though as soon as the ink cooled on those headliners, her career was overshadowed by her scandalous death, and her movie sank into a form of irrelevance and became unimportant. Because Thelma Todd never shined to show her full potential, and her life was cut short seemingly at the height of her career, not much thought was given to her entire story, just that she was involved in some shady business, and the debate of her suicide versus murder. But in the first installment in a Thelma Todd series, we're going to focus on her life and her underappreciated career. Truth is, she was Hollywood's blonde bombshell, and was considered an amazing comedian, and at one time up there with some of the greats. Her features were relatively well received, and she was a savvy business manager. But how did it all end up here? Let's start from the beginning. Thelma Alice Todd was born in Lawrence, Massachusetts on July 29, 1906 to John and Alice Todd, who were both immigrants from Ireland and Canada. She was the youngest child, only having an older brother, William Todd, who tragically passed away at the age of 7 in 1910 when his pant leg got caught in a shafting machine in a creamery. Thelma, her mother, and her brother spent the summer in Vermont, where they were staying with Mrs. Todd's immediate family while Mr. Todd remained back in Lawrence. According to the reports of her brother's death, at the time of the incident, Thelma, her brother, and their cousins went to explore the creamery unattended. Usually, the employees would keep the children from getting too close to the machinery, but on this one occasion, no one was supervising. William Todd got too close to the machine and his pant leg got caught. He was revolved around the machinery several times before the manager was able to unhook him. He had a broken neck, leg, and arm. He lived only for a few minutes before passing away. Thelma, who had witnessed the tragedy, was left scarred. Her cousins that she was very close to have revealed later on that Thelma was deeply distressed by the accident. But it also left a different kind of scar. A few nights after William's tragic death, Thelma had snuck down the stairs to the sound of her father crying. She peered through the railing and overheard her father saying, "Why did it have to be him?" Thelma was left with an enormous amount of guilt, and that haunted her for the rest of her life. Although her father didn't mean that he would have rather lost Thelma, she took it that way. So for the rest of her life, she wanted to be the son that he lost. She took that ambition and used it to excel in school. She was highly intelligent and was claimed to be one of the top students in her class. There was never any doubt that Thelma could do something great. But she was anything but a cautious child. She was always a daredevil who could not be controlled. She was carefree and very spirited. She was also known to put her life in danger several times from her reckless driving, riding her bicycle as fast as the wind, and her affinity for horseback riding at breakneck speed. She should not be confused with a careless individual. She was always full of energy and had much enthusiasm for thrills. After her initial debut, an article was written to help demystify the lovely New England girl. In an effort to help advertise her new career, Thelma agreed to provide the story of her first few steps to fame. When she graduated high school, she started working as a fabric clerk, working for a five and dime. Her beauty would bring in men from all ages, and they would crowd her department. Thelma used to take part in a dance on weekends, where men would have to buy a ticket to dance with her. After they would dance, they would inquire more about her. That's when she told them where she worked. So very regularly would Todd have these suitors come to visit and distract her from her job. Housewives would avoid going into the store because the crowds were too massive. The manager noticed business was suffering, and the men that would come to gawk at Todd were not buying anything, and they were hard to disperse. Todd was directly to blame, and management had no choice but to dismiss her. A few weeks later, a local cotton mill was putting on a fashion show to display their clothing. Todd was hired and put to work immediately, but she did not help sales there either. She was too beautiful to wear cotton. the public thought the clothing was only a disinterest to the beauty of the models. The fashion shows were quickly stopped, leaving Todd out of a job again. Although it is likely to be an embellished tale to give Thelma an interesting backstory, we can't prove that it doesn't contain a grain of truth. We do know for certain that she went back to school to make a career in education. In fact, it was her mother that pushed Thelma into going into a teaching career, and she was enrolled at the Lowell Normal School, now known as State Teachers College. There she was nicknamed the Little Queen because of her long blonde hair. Her flapper friends all had bobbed hair, but Thelma preferred hers long and curly. She worked as a student teacher and had all the makings for a bright career in education, but that was very short-lived. Thelma Todd's first boyfriend worked for the Empire Theater, which was owned by a man named Napoleon Demera, who owned six of Lawrence's prestigious theaters. He lined his walls with photographs of famous stars that came to visit his theaters. Her boyfriend encouraged his manager to get a good look at her and possibly recommend her to the Paramount Studios. After seeing Todd, Demera reached out to representatives for Paramount Studio, and they brought her in for a meeting with Jesse Lasky, an executive at Paramount Studios, and initially he was not impressed. He was just about to call the meeting off when Mrs. Todd told Thelma to let down her hair. Lasky saw how long and beautiful her hair was, and he was immediately impressed and gave her a screenshot. She was promised a place in the new and upcoming Paramount School for Junior Stars, which was owned by Paramount Movie Studio. At this time, the school was just opened and only would accept the best candidates who seemed to have a real look for the screen. But there was a disadvantage. The requirements to enter the school was by means of a contest, and all applicants would need to either submit an essay or have a title from a beauty pageant. Todd did not have either, and she was cutting entry time very close. The agents at Paramount were very happy to help her out. Although she was a very beautiful young woman, and she was encouraged by her friends and family to enter into local beauty pageants, Todd refused, saying that she did not like that sort of attention. But the agents trying to get her into the Paramount School highly insisted that she enter the pageant at the Elks Club in Essex County. The winner would receive a silver loving cup, a wardrobe worth $500 to compete in, the title Miss Essex County, and a chance to earn the Miss Massachusetts title in another pageant. Thelma refused to enter, but agreed to watch the performance. She was in awe by the beautiful women and even seeing prior beauty pageant winners on the stage. Before the judges made their choice, Thelma left her group of friends and ran up onto the stage and stood among all the other contenders. She gave a big smile to the judges, and they were all impressed by her lovely figure and graceful jump onto the stage. She was given the title Miss Essex County, and she later went on to win the title of Miss Massachusetts in June of 1925. The problem was that both beauty contests were fixed to allow Thelma to win. Although Thelma did not approve, and she burned a lot of bridges with the contestants, she needed that experience to get her into the school. She was rumored to be a contestant in Miss America, but she actually did not take part in that competition. She was expected to be in New York on July 8th, which was only a few weeks after winning Miss Massachusetts. Her parents jumped at the opportunity and left Massachusetts to settle in New York to help support Thelma's future. The Paramount School offered thousands of young men and women the chance to learn from the best acting coaches and give them a very real perspective of Hollywood life and careers, with the promise of a contract at the end of the program. The school was located in the Paramount Long Island studio in Astoria, New York, with tuition costing $500 for 6 months and the students paying $25 a week in expenses. Men between the ages of 18 to 30 and women 16 to 25 would be accepted, and the curriculum included lessons on what you would expect: acting, expression, speech, fashion and costume, makeup application, dancing, swimming, horseback riding, driving a car, and included many other things. Applications would have had written form plus 3 photographs showing front and profile portraits and a full body shot. Of the thousands of applications sent in, only 10 men and 10 women would be chosen for the final count. The class would begin on July 13th and end on December 5th, and only 16 students seeing their graduation day, with 2 dropping the courses within the first few days and 2 not meeting expectations. After graduation, only few of the students would sign a contract with Paramount and earn $75 for the first 6 months and an increase of $25 for another 6 months for as long as 7 years if the studio decided to keep them that long. After graduation, the former classmates were cast for their first film together called Fascinating Youth, which was released in March of 1926. Not all the graduates were successful and did not carry a long career. Some graduates never appearing in more than 5 films. Todd was one of the successful few. Contrary to popular belief, Fascinating Youth was not Todd's first appearance in a film. She actually played in an uncredited role in 1926's The Devil's Circus, where she made a 10-second appearance with her long natural hair. This may have been filmed while Todd was still enrolled in school, because this film was released 1 month before Fascinating Youth. Todd's future career was not going to be easy. While she was enrolled in the Paramount School, she was constantly warned to watch her weight, and when she signed her contract, she was under a term called the Potato Clause, which prohibited Todd from gaining more than 5 pounds from her weight when she was signed. Todd was reported to weigh 149 pounds when she was enrolled in school and had to slim down to a weight of 115 before signing her contract. This wasn't an unusual practice for the time. Many famous celebrities were under contract for weight management, so not much thought went behind signing something like this. But it brought a lot of stress onto the star to keep a trim figure. Todd especially felt that pressure. To help take the edge off, the studio gave Thelma diet pills, which she would later become addicted to. Although Thelma's drug usage has not been proven, it's not an uncommon belief given the time of her arrival in Hollywood. Thelma also had a terrible habit of starving herself to keep her figure, which did not go unnoticed. But it certainly didn't help that because Thelma had a hard time keeping her weight down to where it was expected to be, other actors would point it out to her. For example, Thelma Todd once walked up to actor Richard Dix, and she excitedly said that she would one day be his co-star, and he retorted, "Not until you lose that weight, you won't." Thelma was shocked. Her first few films that she was featured in were not filmed in Hollywood. While all the other Paramount graduates went on to California to see if they would be officially signed by Paramount, Todd stayed behind to work on different sets for the studio. It was also required for Todd and the other graduates to travel to each student's hometown to advertise their success. But Todd was already working, so she also had to go out to promote her own career, which meant she was constantly on the go, with little time to celebrate her success. It was during Todd's travels when her father suddenly passed away in 1926 of a heart attack while he was waiting for a bus. At the time, Thelma was out of state to promote her second film, God Gave Me 20 Cents, when she got the call about her father. It was her 20th birthday. Todd never liked to talk about the loss of her father, and she felt an overwhelming sense of responsibility to become a provider for her mother. Thelma settled in Los Angeles and flew her mother in to keep her close by. According to a few sources, Thelma had suffered with numerous health problems, and only a few hours after her father's funeral, Thelma collapsed and had to have an emergency appendectomy. Thelma needed the support of her mother now more than ever. And as if to add to Thelma's stress, her second boyfriend, Robert Andrews, purposely did not show up to Mr. Todd's funeral and had broken up with Thelma when he cut off all ties with her. Todd and her mother had a very devoting bond to each other. They both had suffered from their losses, and they were all that each other had. Thelma made sure that they were both living comfortably, but this required her to work very hard to keep up with her newfound career in Hollywood. New actresses arrived in Los Angeles on a regular basis, and they all had dreams to live a lifestyle of the rich and famous. Although Todd had the edge of her wits and her sophisticated education, it became very clear to her that you could be famous one day and out in the streets the next if your audience got tired of you. After all, her fellow classmates from New York had the same amount of education she had, and their careers did not amount to anything. And after Fascinating Youth was released, some names would never be seen again. Thelma worked very hard, and she was working as an extra in a lot of films. Financially, she had money coming in, but she was known to save every dime. She enjoyed fast cars, jewelry, and silk gowns, but she saved most of her money so she could set up a trust fund for her mother. That doesn't mean that she never spent her money. She was just very careful with it. Todd had lost a lot of money when the stock market crashed, so she had preferred to invest in jewelry as she saw this as a way to maintain her finances in a safer way for the future. Thelma was one of the highest pinnacles of fashion at the time and was well known for wearing the most extravagant furs and expensive jewelry. In 1929, she was featured in a short documentary where she displayed her fashion sense. Although her participation in the film has been lost, it leaves behind the clues of her once sought-after style. Among all the rumors circulating about her lifestyle, one said she was also notoriously known to be the life of the party, a happy-go-lucky spirit who knew how to have fun. Once she was unveiled to the public, she was reserved for roles that only made her a pretty figure. She was never given any actual lines or substantial parts, and any movie she did play the leading lady, it was never a box office hit. Her first leading part in a movie was in the 1927 film Nevada, where she starred with a young Gary Cooper. In 1928, Thelma was picked up by a director named Benjamin Christensen. He was very well known for making mystery and science fiction silent films. He used Todd in a few of his mystery horror films. Her first film working for him was actually in The Devil's Circus back in 1926, and it suggested he gave her some acting advice and wanted to use her in a few more of his films now that she had more experience. She played in a movie called The Haunted House, which was released in 1928. And was presumed to be lost, but has since been discovered, and as of 2020, the UCLA Film and Television Archives is in the active process of preserving and restoring it, so keep an eye out for its future release. And in 1929, she starred in the macabre horror film called Seven Footprints to Satan, which was also directed by Christensen. It was a box office flop and left the audience uninspired, although now it could be considered a cult classic. Her final film with Christensen was also in 1929, called The House of Horror. This was Christensen's second to last feature before he left Hollywood to return home to Denmark. This movie was a success and had a comedic edge which may have paved the way for Thelma's future career in comedy. This film is presumed to be lost. Her first few years in Hollywood were not as glamorous as she expected. She was hard at work to keep her name in the theaters, just as many newcomers in Hollywood must face, but she never seemed to play more than a secondary character. In order to keep herself active in the business, she would go between different movie studios to keep her filming career fresh and exciting. But that didn't make anything easier for her. Hollywood was a big business, and at the time of Thelma's introduction, there were a lot of things that happened behind movie studio doors, some that need no explanation. What a lot of outsiders didn't realize was that well-known and big-name stars of the screen had an easier time getting parts for movies. They were highly requested by their fans, and it was a no-brainer if they were box office hits. But for the more experimental films that were considered B-list, the actors and actresses had to jump through all sorts of hoops to get their name in lights, and a lot of studio heads took advantage of their power. For example, sometime in 1928, Thelma was told that she needed to cut her long hair to comply with the style of the short and curly bob. She hesitated, but ultimately gave in to the pressure. But that's not the only kind of direction she was given by the Hollywood officials. She also had to live by their rules. Another example, Todd was let out of a role because she refused to attend a Hollywood party with drunken men. If you don't know what I'm implying, It was a casting couch kind of situation. It's unknown what film it was, but it was with First National Pictures. She was called out to a party where when she arrived, she walked straight into an orgy. Young unknown women who wanted to become something in the film industry fell prey to this on a regular basis. And those were the type of women who attended. Todd was directed to get involved with two of the women, and she refused. The director of this film she was supposed to star in gave her an ultimatum. Either she did what she was told, or her contract was done. Todd walked away from the party, and she took her business with her. She was replaced by another actress, and First National cut her contract right then and there. If you don't believe things like this happened in Hollywood, I'd like to direct you to a documentary called Girl 27. I didn't have as much knowledge about these incidents until I watched this unfortunate and devastating film. Thelma was being controlled, and it's especially obvious she needed to self-medicate to cope with all the stress that was suddenly put on her shoulders between the sudden death of her father, her mother now being dependent on her daughter, and Hollywood's tight grasp. Thelma already had suffered from anxiety with her first few bouts of exposure to the lifestyle, and she was having panic attacks from all the events that were occurring without a break. This is where I speculate Todd took up the habit of drinking. It's no secret that Hollywood was a shock to Thelma. But this wasn't the only time Thelma lost her lead in a film due to different opinions. Somewhere in the late 1920s, Todd was cast to play the leading lady in Howard Hughes' successful Hell's Angels. But Todd's participation in the film was very short-lived. It's hard to tell what exactly got her cut from this movie, and although this movie was released with sound in 1930, it had originally started out being a silent film. Historians are not completely certain if Todd worked for the entire film, but promotional cards still exist listing Todd as the leading female character. We do know that Todd was eventually cut out of the film, with newspapers claiming she simply changed her mind. But we don't know why. There's multiple speculations where some can assume, since it's Howard Hughes, she wasn't cooperating with him. Take that how you will. But the more likely explanation may be that the film was taking too long to make, and Thelma's schedule wouldn't allow her to wait around forever. Another reason may be because Hughes switched directors, and Todd was not the director's choice. Ultimately, she was replaced by Greta Neeson, where she completed the entire feature. But when sound was making its headline in studios, Howard Hughes scrapped the entire movie and refilmed it with Jean Harlow taking the lead, which was her first leading opportunity in film. This could have been Todd's big break. Every Todd historian claimed that this would have changed the game for her. In 1928, Todd starred in her favorite film, The Vamping Venus. Although the film has been lost, it is widely requested and hopefully will turn up in the future. In this movie, Todd plays a seductive version of the Grecian goddess Venus in ancient Greece. The movie was considered a comedy and may have given great rise to her comedic career. All the newspapers praised Todd for her performance, and even today, in Todd's former scrapbook, she held onto many pieces of paper that highlighted her role. Todd's first foot in the business wasn't that successful, and she was left to worry about her future career until a director by the name of Hal Roach, who's famous for his Laurel and Hardy shorts, used Todd to appear in a few slapstick episodes. She played a part in Laurel and Hardy's very first talkie called Unaccustomed As We Are. The title was a playoff of a popular cliché, as unaccustomed as we are to public speaking. Since Todd's parts in the episode were so well received, Roach gave Todd more lines and more spotlight, and every time he became more and more impressed with her.
Thank you. Oh, pardon me.
Hello. Oh, how do you do, Mrs. Hardy? I want to talk to your husband.
Give me that phone.
Pardon me, dear. Just a moment. Excuse me. Hello?
Hey, Ollie. You'll have to hurry. I can't get organized.
Oh, all right.
Well. Gee, it's great to hear from you again. Yes, I'll be around and see you tomorrow. Goodbye. An old schoolmate of mine. We used to room together. I think we'd better go in and see the guest.
We've decided to go home. Good night.
Not long after working with Laurel and Hardy, she was used in other shorts and was pinned alongside Charlie Chase. Because of her continued success, Hal Roach felt compelled to give her the leading opportunity in his new series and teamed her up with the famous Zazu Pitts in hopes to create a female version of the successful Laurel and Hardy.
Would you get up and get her on that table?
but you don't understand.
Things will occur.
Thelma.
And you know how it is. You can't always judge people.
Thelma.
And me.
Take your...
I'm gonna knock that guy's block off.
Oh, you and who else?
Me and nobody else.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Todd and Pitts worked together in 17 episodes. When Todd starred in these shorts, she was scripted to play the level-headed and hard-working woman who is constantly put in embarrassing situations by her ditzy friend. Pitts was usually relied on playing the more dim-witted parts. Pitts and Todd had worked together previously 2 years prior in the film Her Private Life, so they were already well acquainted. They became fast friends through their career, and it's especially obvious that the two of them were having fun working off of each other's jokes. By this time, Pitts already had a very impressive past when it came to her filmography, being credited for 95 films by the time their comedy shorts began in 1931. One of the episodes in 1932 was directed by Jules White, and was later recycled in 1936 for a Three Stooges episode. When compared next to each other, the episodes are nearly identical, provided a reverse in genders.
Yeah. Thank you, pardon. What? You two again? Oh, another fertile monkey. Take him away.
Say, you don't need to get so high hat. Your ancestors swung for trees, too.
Oh! Talent! If these organ grinds get on this train with that monkey, I'm through. I quit.
Oh, God. Remember the show. Now just go inside and compose yourself. I'll get rid of it. This train is for the hot shot.
Well, we're Pitt
and Todd.
Yes.
I was afraid of that. Well, you'll have to put the monkey in the baggage car.
Well, Napoleon means an awful lot to our ass.
Well, if anything happens to him, you can put on a beard and play the part yourself. Now, come on, scram, because I don't want to miss the show. Come on, beat it, girl. Beat it.
He might get hurt.
I said he goes in the baggage car. You guys don't work. Now, scram!
All aboard!
Get off board, baggage car. Come on, get on.
Hurry up. Hey, could you tell us girls that what number we sleep in? You know? Why, I heard the manager say you take the drawing room.
The drawing room? Look, he's sorry for what he did to us, and now he's trying to make up. Well, goodbye, girl.
Bye.
Can you tell us where we boys bunk tonight?
Why, yes, that's your drawing room down there.
Okay, honeysuckle, we'll be seeing you later. All right, boys.
With Pitt's popularity rising from her involvement in these comedies, and her already incredible history in the industry, she was starting to get into the full feature movie career, and because of her unique voice, she was offered jobs working on comedy radio series. There were even cartoon characters based off of her personality, for example, Olive from Popeye. Zazu left in 1933 for better opportunities, but she and Todd remained very close friends. Pitts and Todd were often seen attending events together off-screen, and even known to jointly throw parties. Zazu's last episode was One Track Minds, which was released in May. To replace Pitts, Roach then cast Patsy Kelly, who was still new to Hollywood. Kelly was different in style compared to her predecessor. She was playing more of a tough girl sort of role, and this went well with Todd's character's personality. Kelly and Todd also had a strong friendship that even lasted off-screen. In August of 1933, Kelly was in an automobile accident that left her with serious injuries. Although Kelly had only been working on set for a very short amount of time, Thelma still would visit Kelly while she was recovering to help build publicity.
If you don't mind.
Well, you got the wrong girl. Boys, there's the one over here. Come on.
No, listen, I am not getting on that stretcher. I'm not hurt.
You see, officer, she's hysterical. Then a little bit off her nut from the crash. Now, come on. You're right over there,
Mr. Listen, I'm not getting on that stretcher. I'm not hurt.
Come on, now, just get over there. That's
I won't get in. We're going.
Quiet
now,
okay? Find the way. Huh?
This night's going on.
Come on, boys.
Let me out of here.
Quiet, boys. You're all right. All right, boys, take her to my apartment.
Oh, she's gone.
Whoa.
I am not.
Will you stop your clowning?
Will you get me out of here?
Come on, turn him over, boys. Turn him over. All right, take her inside and stand her up, boys. Get her right in there.
Oh.
That's the idea.
Oh, what a marvelous apartment.
Where am I? Oh! Oh!
Oh!
Oh, will you get me out of here?
Just a minute.
Oh, get me out of here! Oh,
get off now.
Listen, first I'm upside down. This is fine. Would you please tell me what this is all about?
We're wasting a lot of time. The adjusters will be here any minute.
What do you mean, adjusters?
Those are the men who'll tell you how badly you're hurt.
If he says hurt again, I'm telling you, we'll go mad.
Not at all. Calm, dear. Quiet, dear. Are you choking me? It's a good thing she didn't have twins.
Oh, Patsy, will you kindly speak to baby?
I knew that was coming. Don't cry, that's all. There. Now, madam, don't you think this is baby? No. Nice baby. Don't blame me.
Miss Todd, when you're finished with your customer, I'd like you to come up to the front window. I want to talk with you. And you too.
There you are. The customer's always right again.
And we're wrong again. Girls, you don't seem very anxious to make a sale.
Madam, have you found your color?
No, there's nothing here quite my vibration. I don't think I'll take anything with me today.
Oh! You'll take this with you, won't you?
Certainly.
Thanks. Come on, Patsy. We got a date.
Even though Todd was still missing Pitts, she still did eventually warm up to Kelly, only to end up having a very strong friendship. Todd had continued these shorts all the way until her death, making a grand total of 38 episodes. While she was still working these comedies, she was cast in 1931 to star in a feature-length movie, Corsair. The film was directed by Roland West, whom Todd would later become romantically involved with, and carry on the affair for 4 years. This movie was West's last film he would direct, and it starred Todd alongside Chester Morris, who is considered West's closest friend. West and Todd had met while on a ship to attend a party on Catalina Island. It was this occurrence that inspired West to use Todd for his last movie, and that is why it is also filmed off of Catalina Island. The acting given by Todd gave her the edge she needed to show Hollywood she was more than just jokes. She could be sexy and desirable, but more importantly, it showed how fiery she was.
Not bad.
She is not my woman.
Ain't she? Fine.
Keep your hands off her.
Nah, you ain't stuck on her. That's for lying, Heister.
He has a sideline, one he thinks no one knows about. But I know. The next time you see me, I'll be taking money your father wouldn't have the guts to take. Only there'll be no widows or orphans where I'm going to get mine.
And to think that I wasted a perfectly good kiss on you.
Now that's goodbye from a He-Man son of the West.
West had taken Todd under his wing, and she took his advice professionally. West had suggested Todd change her stage name to Allison Lloyd for a brief period because he did not feel that she should use the name Thelma Todd, which was associated with comedy. However, I believe it was Hal Roach who told Thelma he wouldn't acknowledge her as Allison Lloyd because she was already known as Thelma Todd, and it would only hurt her career to start over with a different name. To resolve this issue, Todd went back to her birth name, but the movie Corsair gives credit to Todd under the name Allison Lloyd. Although West and Todd were having an affair, West was married to Jewel Carmen, a retired silent film star. They had been married for 13 years before West started his affair with Todd. According to West, he had been estranged from his wife for a long time, but they had never officially divorced until 1938. But when later questioned by reporters, Carmen claimed that she did not care about Todd and West's relationship, and they carried on as they pleased without Carmen's interference. Although, many historians speculate that Todd only started the affair with West so that other directors would not try to take advantage of her. Todd was now considered a highly successful comedic actress, and thanks to the shorts that she was playing in, she was loaned out to other studios to make appearances in other films. Although she has been credited to play in nearly 60 films, it is believed that she may have been in over 120 films and shorts, where in only a handful of them she was uncredited. She even played in the original 1931 version of The Maltese Falcon. Compared to its 1941 remake starring Humphrey Bogart and Mary Astor, the original was considered very lewd with its sexual and homosexual themes. It was banned by the production code and copies were heavily edited. But the unedited version was well received in its time, and Todd was praised for her performance.
Hello, Sam.
Hello, Iva. How are you, honey? I'm glad to see you.
I came to talk to you, Sam. Can't I go in?
I'm very busy right now.
Don't be silly. I came to talk to you, and I'm not going to stay out here.
Come here.
I saw. Who's that dame wearing my kimono?
Now behave yourself, honey.
Oh, I suppose I haven't any right where you're concerned. Well, I thought I had. I thought your pretending to love me gave me some.
Well, let's not talk about that now. What do you want?
Oh, just to talk to you, Sam. I must. I've got to.
I haven't got the time.
All right. If you won't listen to me, I know someone who will. Lieutenant Dundee might be interested in what I've got to say. I'll be seeing you.
She appeared in the 1932 movie, This Is the Night, where she worked with Cary Grant in his first role ever in a film. The movie was not well received and even had Grant threatening to never get back into show business because he hated his character so much. Todd, however, received no criticism or praise. This film didn't seem to help her career, but it did blatantly show what Hollywood thought of Todd. In almost every other scene, Todd's character somehow ends up losing her dress. It was her future comedic movies that put her back into the spotlight, where she starred with the Marx Brothers in Horse Feathers in 1932. She already had a history of working with them back in 1931, where she played the leading female in Monkey Business. But Horse Feathers was much more praised and even to this modern day holds awards for the funniest quotes and most notable scenes.
Do you know, Professor, I've never seen football signals. Do you think a little girl like me could understand them?
I think a little girl like you would understand practically anything.
Is Great Big Strong Man going to show Little Icky Baby all about the bad football signals?
Was that you or the duck? Because if it was you, I'm going to finish this ride with the duck.
If Icky Baby don't learn about the football signals, Icky Baby going to cry.
If Icky Girl keep on talking that way, Big Strong Man's going to kick all her teeth right down her throat.
A naughty man just only fooling. Just for that, I'm coming right over there and smother naughty man with kisses.
You couldn't make that onions instead, could you? Oh, so that's your game. That's your game, is it?
Professor Wagstaff! Professor Wagstaff!
Oh, just call me Quincy. After you get to know me, buddy, you can call me Quince.
Oh, throw me the lifesaver. The lifesaver. Oh, Professor Wagstaff, please hurry, Professor.
In 1932, she was also in Buster Keaton's Speak Easily, which starred Keaton and Jimmy Durante. This was also not as praiseworthy as the Marx Brothers films, but Todd was still beloved nonetheless.
I got laid.
I assumed as much.
Assume nothing. Say, get an eye full of this.
Sign her up, Professor. Something like this. Get away from you, Professor. She's great, I'm telling you. If you see this gal...
Well? Get out of my way. What are you doing here? I told the Professor to fire you.
Listen, Aspare, I'm warning you. You leave the Professor alone.
What? Why, we're going to be married.
If I didn't know you were lying, I'd shake the silly little head off you. I'll do it anyway.
Stop it, you little fool, you. Professor! Professor! She's gone crazy.
Miss Pansy.
Oh, you little nitwit, you.
Although Todd has always played the vamp in whatever movies she was featured in, if she was the leading lady, she played the more sultry and desirable woman. And if she was the supporting actress, she played the sexy other woman. It's no wonder why Todd's general personality off-screen is confused with her having the sexual appetite of a goddess who leaves behind a trail of broken hearts. That couldn't be further from the truth. Todd gave an interview for Screenplay magazine in February of 1932, where she was questioned about her love life. Todd was very shy to talk about her intimate affairs, but did not deny that she did have many admirers sending her gifts and love letters on the regular. When Catherine Hunter, who was interviewing her, tried to describe what made Thelma such an attraction, she is quoted as saying, "Hers is a much more insidious, dangerous fascination, for she's utterly charming, simple, natural, and naively unaware of the spell she casts." And when Todd was asked what she's looking for in a man, Thelma admitted that she was looking for a husband. She didn't like playboys. She explained that she wanted to work hard to help set up a trust fund for her mother, then she wanted to think about settling down and starting a family. Although it was reported that she was briefly engaged to 5 men, she rescinded her answer and went back on the hunt. One man she was known to have dated was the famous bandleader Abe Lyman. Little is known to how long they had been together, but they were engaged. Their relationship ended on bad terms when Abe had cheated on Thelma. She called off the engagement, but Abe didn't even bother to come pick up the ring himself. He had his brother retrieve it from Thelma. She was very heartbroken, but that ultimately cemented her desire not to date playboys, and to marry a good man from Boston. Another man she was known to be engaged to was Ivan Lebedev, who was a Russian actor. The relationship spanned from 1928 to 1929, and in celebration of their engagement, Ivan had pictures taken of Thelma in Russian fashion. Throughout his life, he idolized these pictures. Overall, Todd was far from the vamp you see her play on the screen. 1932 proved to be a big year for her career and her personal life, and it was most certainly apparent her interest from the public did not decline. That same year, she played alongside Clara Bow for a second time in a film called Call Her Savage, where the reception of the film was mostly positive, and it left the audience with an unforgettable scene of Todd fighting with Bow.
Who's that?
That's Sonny Delane.
Oh, yes. She's here with Jack Carter.
Mother.
Mother?
I was just thinking. Hello, Larry. How are you?
Hello.
Hello, Jack.
Hello, Naza. Naza, may I present Miss Delane?
How do you do? They tell me you're dynamite. Yes?
Sonny, please now.
That's all right. Dynamite doesn't fight me. I've been in a lot of explosions. I was wondering why you look so frightfully scarred.
Come on, dear, let's get out of here.
No.
Come on, Sonny, please now.
I suppose you know you broke up my home. I didn't know that you were in a home. When did you get out? Say, listen, you. And you.
I think the girls are going to get together.
2-1 on Nazi.
I don't know. Sonny's pretty good. There they go.
They're off.
Oh,
Naza, darling, stop it, dear. Naza, Naza, darling, stop it. Stop it, Naza. Naza, darling, stop it.
What is it, Pete?
Winifred, please take Mrs. Springer to her room.
Sonny,
stop it. Let him go, darling. Let him go. Where's Sonny? Sonny, I'm surprised at you. Get out of here now. Come on, let's get out of here.
Todd's overall participation in the drama genre was usually critiqued with a hit-or-miss reception, but she would always bounce back with her comedy features. Whether it was with Hal Roach or other big comedy names, she was still able to pick herself up and carry her reputation with a high amount of sophistication and skill. On July 10, 1932, in Prescott, Arizona, she married Pasquale Pat DeChico, a self-proclaimed agent and movie producer. Rumors surrounded Pat from the start. He was alleged to be affiliated with notorious mobster Lucky Luciano and was tangled up in crimes like drug dealing and prostitution. According to sources, Pat and Thelma had a highly unstable marriage where they were not just arguing, they would physically beat each other up. On one occasion, Todd had given him a broken nose, while DeChico beat Todd so bad one night she had to have an emergency appendectomy. I use quotes on that because we're not really sure what the procedure was, And as previously mentioned earlier, Todd already had her appendix out in 1926. These fights were fueled by alcohol, and according to many sources, Thelma Todd was a well-known alcoholic. She was always known to get roaring drunk at parties and be very confrontational given her righteous upbringing. She had no problem putting people in their place or defending herself. DeChicco had forcibly gained control of Thelma's career and had her fire her manager Jerry Mayer so that Pat could replace him. With him pulling the strings, Thelma's career path started to change drastically. He scheduled interviews for her, which Thelma did not like to do. She was very private about her personal life. But although DeChicco was very open to the idea of getting Todd heavily advertised, he couldn't handle rejection. In 1933, Todd had left for Europe with her friend Sally Eilers, and reports had come out claiming Thelma was having an affair with former co-star Dennis King. This was not uncommon in the world of Hollywood. Sometimes when watching actors have a romantic affair on screen, there were assumptions of chemistry off screen. They starred together in a Laurel and Hardy movie called The Devil's Brother.
As I told you before, my lord, our money is securely hidden.
Well, who guards it so loyally?
I do.
You do?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't see it on you.
Of course you don't. Though it's not very far from you.
Well, let me guess where it's hidden.
Uh-huh.
Is it in your bag?
It's much nearer to me than that.
Is it, in your bodice?
Uh-huh.
I know. It's hidden in the folds of your gown.
Oh! Oh, my lord!
Is it very close to your fair white skin? Is it? Why do you tempt me this way with your beauty?
Oh, please, my lord, please.
Don't you know that I'm falling in love with you? And that I can't bear the thought of you belonging to someone else?
Oh, but I do belong to someone else. And we must remember it.
I remember nothing else except that I love you. And that I can't stand the temptation of being near you. Pamela, I can't give you up. And yet I dare not stay.
Oh, but my lord, I've come to depend on you for the only life and gaiety in my life. Surely we can still be friends.
Do you think with the perfume of your hair, the light in your eyes, the nearness of your lovely self always tempting me, that we can be friends?
Pat was livid at the idea, and Thelma had said that she was scared to come home to face him. She took a side trip to visit family in Lawrence before returning to their home in North Hollywood. When she returned, DeChicco had interviews lined up for her and publicity photo shoots. She smiled for the cameras, but behind that grin, she was plotting her divorce. To keep Pat happy, she swooned at the mention of being home and back into the arms of her loving husband. DeChicco was claimed to be physically abusive by his other wives. His second wife, Gloria Vanderbilt, mentioned that he used to pound her head against a wall. But the difference between his later wives and Todd was that Todd could handle her own. She was described as being a woman who could take a hit if you could manage to land it. But she also didn't like to be told what to do. So when they divorced in 1934, the two went their separate ways and kept a less than friendly relationship, although they still ran in the same circles. Todd was reported to being very happy about the end of her marriage and had no shame in being open about DeChicco's abuse. She made sure he did not receive 1 cent of her hard-earned money. Her filming career had continued without the miss of a beat, but she was suffering from her stress and drinking habit, which was now deemed out of control. Although it was not officially noted if she had an addiction to drugs from her constant fear of gaining weight, she did, however, indulge on her regularly excessive alcohol use to help take the edge off. Because of this, she was involved in multiple car accidents due to her condition. The movie studio highly recommended she have a chauffeur to help protect herself from danger and to also keep her name out of the press. In fact, in one of the car accidents in 1933, Todd purposely drove into a tree while she was in a heated argument with DeChicco. After the end of her marriage, Todd had continued her relationship with West, but in his words, it was nothing more than a friendship. And with his financial investing, Todd was made a figurehead for a new restaurant, Thelma Todd's Sidewalk Cafe. It was very successful and drew in celebrities and tourists from all over. The ground floor was the Sidewalk Cafe, while the second floor was called the Joya Cafe, which was reserved for people with a more lucrative reputation. There's a lot of misunderstanding believing that Todd owned this cafe. She was, mainly, just the ultimate decider in the cafe's design and menu. Her name was used for advertising, and her image alone would bring in customers. But that doesn't mean that she was just an employee. I think she was the next best thing to an owner. She had all the power behind the cafe, but not the property. This could have been an opportunity for West to make money and officially live with Todd under a guise and not arousing suspicion. Keep in mind though, Todd was the face of the Thelma Todd Sidewalk Cafe. West was a financial investor, but Jewel Carmen, who helped West's investment, was the noted actual owner of the cafe. Todd had lived in an upstairs apartment in a three-story building, while West had lived in a separate room next to Thelma's, which was only separated by a partition. West owned the mansion a stone's throw away from the cafe where his wife lived, but West ultimately ended up moving into the cafe's apartment. At first, Todd did not live in the cafe. She had a nice apartment that she shared with her friend. But there were robberies that had taken place and were incredibly personal to Thelma. For instance, Thelma had returned home to find all her underwear was stolen, just her underwear. She felt very threatened by the act and sought out to be protected. Wes had asked her to move into the cafe, and he had moved into the apartment next to hers to keep a watchful eye. However, Thelma did suspect that West may have been behind the panty raid to scare her into living with him in the cafe. In 1933, Todd's film career would go through lulls every now and then, and although 1932 and 1933 were great years for Todd, her character importance was starting to wane. She was used to having more leading opportunities, but she was being relinquished to a specific type of character. She was always playing the other woman kind of role. Although most films had her playing as a supporting actress, she finally found a happy balance in her drama genre. Her first film to signal in 1933 was Air Hostess, where her character was highly praised and she was considered the height of seduction.
Thank you.
Mrs. Carmen, wouldn't you like to make a statement before you leave?
Oh, I'm sure I'll have something much more interesting to say when I return from Los Angeles. So please don't ask me any more questions now.
All right. Thank you very much.
Goodbye.
Who is she?
Hey, haven't you ever heard of Sylvia Carlton?
No.
Why, she picked up a couple of $1 million, divorcing four or five rich husbands. What's more, she's publicity crazy, has a yen for any kind of a celebrity. She has homes in Chicago and New York, and she has a gorgeous ranch right here in Albuquerque.
How do you do, Mr. Miller? I'm flying with you again.
Yes, so I see.
I know you'll be extra careful.
Why, surely.
You're all right, Mrs. Carlton.
Oh, please call me Sylvia.
All right, I'll call you Syl for short. You're gorgeous.
Ooh. You almost broke a non-stop record.
Live, love, and laugh.
Oh, I wouldn't do too much of that.
Why not?
Because I don't want you to get too drunk.
And don't worry about me, Syl.
Be
big-hearted, wasn't she? Being a martyr to the cause of aviation. Making the supreme feminine sacrifice for her dear little hubby. I'd like to slap her face.
What'd you say?
Pretending that she sent you to me for your own good, to achieve your great ambitions. How I hate these namby-pamby wives that cry and whimper and let their husbands step on them so they can feel the more righteous.
For my own good. To achieve my great ambition.
Oh, but why bother about her? She left you with me, so...
I'm just beginning to realize what an idiot I've been.
She must love me. I bet it broke her heart to send me up here, but she did it because she wanted me to make good. And for that, I abused her.
What about your plans?
Oh, you still interested in flying?
Why, of course.
Well, then go fly a kite.
Another film that came out was a British comedy, You Made Me Love You. Todd traveled to Europe once again to star in this prestigious film alongside Stanley Lupino. It wasn't released in the U.S. until 1934. The plot is a modern adaptation of Shakespeare's Taming of the Shrew.
Come down here at once.
Yes, Daddy.
I have their permission, and I only need your permission, and everything will be all right.
All right?
Yes, you see, it's a very awkward situation for all of us, and it only needs you to say yes, and everything will be cleared up.
Yes to what?
Will you... Oh, excuse me. Will you marry me?
Marry you?
Yes, please.
It seems to be going very well.
Uh-huh.
What a girl!
You know, Tom, I think you're doing this all on purpose.
Oh, no, Pam!
You know I'm only a weak woman. It's taking advantage of it. You're treating me like this. You think that before morning I'll be a sweet, loving little wife.
Perhaps.
Well, perhaps not! Get out!
I must stay and protect the woman I love.
Oh, I'd rather be left alone with a pig!
All right, I'll get one.
Get out! Get out! Get out!
Excuse me, darling. I'll have a pickle.
Oh!
Her next big success was Sitting Pretty, also from 1933. The movie itself had a strange concept, as the best way to describe it is a musical about musicals. But Thelma's role was received so well, and although her name is printed below Ginger Rogers, it was widely accepted that Todd played the better leading lady.
A bottle of milk and no lettuce.
Mr. Hughes won't go on for another scene unless he gets a new tin helmet. He didn't like the one we gave.
Blonde, blasé, and beautiful. Inviting, delighting, exciting my fancy. Blonde, blasé, and beautiful. With ultra pulpitude and charm. Is she hot? Has she got what is known as rhythm? Well, I must confess, sir, no, sir, yes, sir. Blonde, blasé, and beautiful. I'm talking about Y-O-U, you sad dude. Hire fixed up for a night, baby. Come up and see me sometime, huh?
Hmm, you can be had.
Another great 1933 film was Palooka.
Hey, Pete, show us your costume. Show us how you locked them out, huh?
Oh, yeah, come on, Jim. Show us. Come on, I know, boy. Well, I'll tell you, it's just how it was, see? It all happened in a twinkling of an eye. I catches him coming in, see? And I nails him with the old reliable. Just like this. Oh, geez, baby, I hurt you?
Oh, no, do it again. I love it.
Oh, congratulations, Mrs. Jan. What can I do for you?
I'm looking for my husband.
Just that.
Yeah? Tell that to the Marines.
She's at the cops. Hello, ma'am. How are you?
Nice of you to be so interested.
Oh, this is a private party, Mamie.
You shut up.
Oh, listen, ma'am. Trixie don't mean anything.
I'll say she do. Are you coming away from this place with me tonight?
Well, you don't want me to walk on my pals, do you?
Are you coming along with me?
Oh, now listen, honey, don't fly off the handle.
If I walk out of this place without you tonight, I walk out for good.
Good?
I told you to shut up. Look here, Pete. You're on the wrong road, and you're walking fast.
That ain't no way to talk to me, ma'am. I'm the champ.
You're the champ, Paul. The champ sucker of Broadway. Too bad you didn't get a beating tonight. You won the fight, but you've lost Joey and me. And there's one other thing that I forgot.
Ow! She hit me!
Ow. He's not the only one in the family who carries a wallop.
It was very obvious that 1933 was a great year and kept Thelma very busy. But she knew how the business worked and knew that this demotion in roles was not going to help her career. The demand in films were changing and it was very hard to keep up with the swift societal changes. Thelma was very aware that her career was going to come to a slow, eventual end. Todd was constantly the target of robberies and death threats. In 1933, she had reported over $2,000 worth of perfume was stolen from her home, and according to her friends, she received death threats on the regular from unwarranted people, and one that was claimed for extortion. And in August of 1935, the man who was threatening Thelma had been arrested in New York. Overall, he sent 8 letters to Todd in hopes of scaring her into giving him money. He was a janitor from Long Island named Harry Szymanski. Abe Lyman, close friend and ex-lover of Todd's, was also threatened to convince Todd to meet Szymanski's demands. Harry was released on bail on November 8th of 1935, but there was also an accomplice, a man named Edward Schaffert, who was a co-worker of Szymanski's. They both threatened to do harm to Todd and her cafe if they didn't receive up to $10,000. Later, they demanded $20,000 and threatened death. She may have come off as a tough girl, but her friends claim that Todd was worried about all these threats coming in. She reported the threats, but when the men were caught, she didn't want to personally press charges. She thought it would give her bad press, and that may make her business suffer. But they were still held accountable to their crimes. Nothing more was ever revealed of what happened to these men. And I know what you're thinking, I'm adding fuel to the conspiracy fire. It is believed that Roland West may have also had a hand in these threatening letters, although that can't be proven. But these weren't the first threatening letters received by Todd. In 1932, she had received a ransom letter for an undisclosed amount, and Thelma did pay the ransom without the police being involved. Perhaps she was seen as an easy target. Unfortunately, due to all the media and conspiracies surrounding Thelma's death, it's hard to really know if the cafe was a true success. It was always swarming with tourists and visitors, but money just wasn't being made. Whether it was because there wasn't enough parking, or simply because money was being laundered out, is really not known. The rumors of the Joya Cafe being an illegal gambling hall are true. In 1932, when alcohol was legal again, there was a huge spike in gambling houses and mafia-related underground businesses. That was not uncommon, but the Joya Cafe wasn't all about gambling. It was still more of a hangout place rather than a casino. It is highly unlikely Todd was entangled in the mafia, and it's not known if the gambling hall was her idea. It's more likely to believe that Roland West was the one who turned the Joya Cafe into an illegal hall. After all, the Joya Cafe was his. Downstairs was all Thelma. Unfortunately, though, the public believe that Thelma owned the entire building. That may be why she was the target of threats. So the real question, was Roland West the one who was affiliated with the mafia unknowingly? The likelihood of the mafia having a hand even in small gambling areas are pretty high, but the idea that it was some sort of underground hall is not feasible. After all, the cafe was right on the Pacific coast, and because unlicensed casinos and illegal gambling were still a crime, many high rollers and celebrities went onto casino ships that floated right outside the US border, making gambling legal. Just because the cafe was not a big gambling house does not mean Thelma didn't gamble. On the contrary, she enjoyed it. She was often seen at casinos or other gambling areas. In fact, there is a horse racing machine in the Joya Cafe. It was noted that Thelma found a way to rig the machine so she could win, all in good fun. Many sources say that Todd had met Lucky Luciano through DeChico, and the two had started an affair. Todd kept a friendship with him in order to use his influence to supply the drugs she needed, but that's widely disputed by historians today. I can't say for certain what I truly believe with this theory. I have heard that there's a paper trail leading Thelma right into Luciano's web, but I've not found that trail. If she was involved in any unsavory groups, I don't think it was of her own willpower. Todd would not be dumb enough to put herself right into the underground's web. In fact, it's very unlikely that Thelma and Luciano would have ever met. All those theories can be traced back to authors who give no sources to these claims, and I found them very discredible. It's still debated if DeChico even had affiliations with him. Plus, Thelma didn't need her supply of amphetamines from the mob if she was already in full supply from her studio. Whether or not these theories are truly accurate, it gives a glimpse into the type of lifestyle Todd was exposed to, and that's where rumors fly about her death. But among all the conspiracies that surround the last few years of her life, we can say one thing is undeniably true. Thelma was hurting. Her anxiety was at an all-time high and her drinking was out of control. It's especially obvious when you look at pictures of her in order of year. She starts to lose her glow, and there's an air of unhappiness about her. Thelma Todd was one of the most kindest people you would ever meet, and she was so generous. Many first-hand accounts will tell you how incredible of a woman she was. It's painful to watch her happiness slowly fade over the years. I will never say that she purposely wanted to give up her career, but you can tell she stopped giving a damn. And I admire that. An honest woman in Hollywood is rare. Learning about Todd's beginnings and her rise to stardom was very much a roller coaster. There was so little information out there, and whatever was available was horribly false. And it was this false information that built how we perceive Thelma today. And I find that very unfair. I think Thelma Todd is one of the most underappreciated and personally over-dramatized actresses in Hollywood history, and I can say that absolutely without fault. Thelma worked very hard, and she deserves every bit of respect for her honesty and compassion. I hope this video reflects that. Yes, she fell on hard times, but that just makes me adore her even more for her conventional talent of being human. I hope this video about her leads to some positive interest in her career, and can help alleviate the pain and the slander that the media left behind. I wouldn't blame you if you question everything presented here to you today. This is a lot to take in. But one thing I promised with making this video was that I would do it right and give Thelma a new and rightly deserved perspective. It's with a heavy heart that I must talk about her death, as I already feel like she's a very good friend of mine. But I won't let the false stories prevail there either. I dedicate this video with a lot of admiration to the true fans of Thelma Todd, the ones who mourn the loss of a bright star, but can look back and wear the biggest grin and hold the most pride for our lovely Thel. I hope this helps their love for Thelma Todd only grow fonder. Thank you.
When the moon is new, I always make a little wish or two. And when I want someone to tell them to, what do? I page Miss Glory. When the stars grow bright and sprinkle all the shadows with their light, to add a little bit of romance to a lovely night, I page Miss Glory. I've never seen a sunset, a rainbow in the sky, that ever could compare with the glory of your eyes. So when we're apart and I begin to feel the teardrops start, and when I get that empty feel way down in my heart, I page Miss Glory.